damage measurement was carried. Are there any declarations of interest? That's it, guys, and all. Item two, the minutes of the last meeting. We all read the minutes?
Yes.
Okay, agreed. The one that we're all waiting for, future council. We've got Kevin McCallum, who's come along to give us a summation and some of the facts and figures on the questionnaire that we put out. Thanks, Kevin.
Okay, thanks, Chair. And thanks to Kevin for coming along tonight. What I'm going to present to you this evening is essentially just the public feedback at the options for this committee. To recap, although we know you've all seen this numerous times before, the financial situation we're covering and why we're actually running this consultation. There's 57 million savings that have actually already been agreed in our council, and I've had a major impact over the next 2 years, so I'll only start feeling the effects of those over next year and the year after, in 2017. You've got 45 million, a minimum of 45 million in new savings that we know we're going to need to find before the end of 2017. That same two-year period. Our projections at the moment are saying in 2018 we're going to need another 25 million on top of that. So that's going to be 70 million new savings over the next 3 years. Of that 70 million, 18 million is required next year, 15-16. This chart and the white enables me to lend itself very well, so I'll make sure everyone gets a hard copy of this as well. It's how that 18 million is made up. 24 million in grant reductions essentially, 14 million in inflation, demographic growth, essentially growth in the budget, offset against 20 million of savings. I mean, what are the agreed that we're going to really impact on next year? So that's 20 million out of that 57 million I mentioned before. So that's all total corporation budget deficit, 15, 16, and 18 million. From that 18 million, the council project went across the entire organisation really. I've been able to identify potential savings, potential efficiencies that total up around 15.5 million. Identifying them and agreeing them with what they're implementing them is a difficult entirely, but they will potentially reduce the budget gap that we're actually looking to bridge next year from 18 million down to 2.5. On the 8th of September this year, the Chief Executive published a series of budget options for just under 4 million next year that we can also put. That gives some church members around 1.5 million. In terms of response to the, now this is purely just the response to the questionnaire that we put out to the public. This is what we've had over the past 5 years, going back to 2010 for a future exercise, right the way through over to 2014. So this year you can see we've got 7,874 responses. Really small percentage in terms of the population, or far and away the biggest in the city region, as big as we can find last year in the response levels out there. A little bit of demographic analysis. This is all broken down in quite a lot more detail than the cabinet report, which was published yesterday. But essentially we've had 3% under 16, which is just under 7% from 16 to 24. Fast bulk response as we get every year, that's from the IFPA bands, 25 to 44, 45 to 64 to 65. We get that every year. It's not representative of the population, but it's what we get, unfortunately, in terms of people taking part. 92% of the sample is, if we've told them their ethnicity, is from white British or other British categories. That's roughly representative of the demographic information in the census. Similarly, in terms of people who've got a disability, 73% of the response, 5% of the unsolved refugee terrorists, state who've got a disability. Geographically, and this chart on the screen compares the four constituencies in terms of the darker bar, which is the percentage of the population that lives in each one of those four constituencies. The blue bar is the percentage of our response that actually live in those constituencies. So what you see is fair kind of more or less bang on in terms of representative. Whittle West is overrepresented. which generally always is, once you've got some slightly over representation, it's his responsibility. I'll come back and answer the next question for me this year. Okay, the next bit is just essentially a breakdown of responsibility in front of you. You've got just under 7,000 in residents, 1,000 members of staff, just under 200 local businesses, 62 partners, and 260 community volunteers. They won't add up to the top response because you could be a better staff and staff and take more cash. But it is just showing them what you do. The next few slides, I was going to take you through the actual feedback we've had from the options. Now, there are lots and lots and lots of options in this particular committee. So, I know the approach you've taken yourselves is three odd. If it's okay with yourselves, you'd have to do that yourself. And these are the options that you didn't get into in much detail. And essentially all I've provided you there is the basic numbers in terms of response levels. So commemorations, registrations and memorials received for the relatively unconcerned about that option, did 60-odd% decide that they were strongly agreed. Similar in terms of the charge increases across allotments, all agreements and local pages, 66% actually agreed with it. Being quite strong with approval against the list of the file enforcement with approaching 80%. Actually agreeing with that option. Cold polling sort of was much more mixed response, with a quarter of people actually not even having an opinion on it either way, but 45% almost people actually disagreed with that one. Similarly, quite mixed in terms of the pest control option as well, the charging of the pest control. As I said, all of this detail is all in the cabinet report as well. This is just a bit of a snapshot really of the feedback we've got. I imagine that the options you picked out to do more detailed work on it, they were selected because you thought that they'd have the biggest impact in the community and the community would be most interested in those particular options. Well, I suppose the first thing to say is you're absolutely right with them. If they were the ones that people were more interested in, they're getting a bit of work, writing in about more and work, making more comments. So we'll take those one at a time. First one was preventative maintenance. I won't go through the detail of the option because I know you've been very good at them recently, but it's 575. That is the result of asking the question then, where we've got just under 30% agreeing, 8% strongly agreeing, or just shy of 15% actually disagreeing or strongly disagreeing. So it's a really mixed response, obviously, so it was a negative response against that particular option. School crossing controls, again, 47 sites with other kind of road crossing procedures in place, potentially 41 being removed. We had a petition that went to council last time in October that I'm sure you're aware of. We also received quite a few letters just a couple of days ago asking to the school crossing control team from schools and from nearby schools on top of the actual question.
Sorry, Kevin, could you speak up, please? You can't hear you above the fire. Yeah, just about here.
I'm not going to be able to speak to fire. Parking in countryside parks, so across Arrow, Eastern, Willow Country Park, and Wayne Country Park. More than a bit unpopular, 61% either disagree or strongly disagree. Quite different actually to the next one, which was the fourth petrol, which is exactly the same promotion, but it's on a different site. You see that it's still a mixed response, but there's a lot more people agree with that than with the countryside park. Say anything to all in the cabinet report about an overall position of what we've got. Public toilets. I've spent far too much time trying to talk to people about public toilets at the moment, but I don't know how long it's been. We've got 10 at the moment. This option would essentially either transfer it to the community or go to the board. That's the response we've got at the moment. So it's almost 60% again, either one or cynical patience to actually put them out. The 198 that were installed at residence requested me to stop filling them up, which is leaving there for residents, community organisations, if they want to put them out. Not, I've more or less the definition of the emergency responsibility right away across. I'm not sure you can draw any conclusions in terms of support or holding that either way. But it's the numbers that's what people said. We didn't get huge amounts of additional feedback in relation to opening the walls, which you can take off the exercise. That was it in terms of the options, Chair. We published all of the results, the detailed results, yesterday afternoon. Cabinet will receive that report on Thursday evening, and we'll just receive that report and open the report in advance of the EFSA court to get the budget resolution in December. Happy to take the questions.
Thanks very much for that. Sure. Interesting results there. Any questions? John?
Just leave it as one of the contingent report on the floor rather than just the I wonder whether the report on the floor public feedback was concerned. The reason I asked him is I think it's good showing the data for this is the last round. There's one item on the which says that a majority agreed with something. And I know that if you did it on the Friday, well, in excess of 4,000 men was a good position on the internet. So those would have taken those against. Was this report written in advance of the consultation?
Thank you, Chair. Okay, the analysis of the consultation is actually the same way as we've done it since 2010. All the feedback that we get goes into an online system. We actually analyse this stuff as we go, because we've always got that time frame. Because we've always got the data between the consultation closing to the second and the second cabinet. So it's all into an online system. The actual reports were populated on Monday morning, essentially. In terms of the specific option, not in terms of the committee, but I do know what option, the option you need. But we've set the numbers in the questionnaire, in terms of what people have said in the questionnaire. But I think if you look at that report, we've also referenced that there's that there's a petition containing so many data sources that would be in the case of council as well. So I think people have gone through.
I hope you've learned as much as cabinet. Down the new road.
that I've given those people minimum charge to basically go to work. Now, is there any way we can see people who strongly disagree where they are from? Because if this is something that people are also in particular opposed to, I think it should be looked at in isolation.
Yes, I can give you the geographic and demographic data. The demographic stuff is dead easy. I can probably do that exactly at the time, but at home, the geographic stuff is a little bit trickier. Technically, remote people, when we ask them where they live, you can just type in the postcode, you know, take the box, so you can just put the data, you know what I mean? I'll have to do a little bit of work on that. Yeah, I'm good, I can do that.
Okay, so then that can be active, but I'd like to try and be the best.
Yeah, thanks for the report. Just two quick questions. Firstly, obviously, Wallasey came out with the lowest in terms of responses to the borough. Was extra effort put in, because you said that's sort of like the normal pattern, has extra effort been put in the past to try and target those areas? And will it be done so in the future if it happens?
I skipped through that a little bit too quickly. The normal pattern is you get all represented in the little west. The normal pattern is better than the lower end. In the flight service and the service for themselves. It's not chat, but they're producing those service for themselves really well organized this year with the whole series of capturing where and that puts that those numbers up. So once he has actually given the lowest numbers in terms of responses, but it takes a percentage of the population is slightly lower.
Yeah.
But what we generally do is what we did is we focused a lot more on the head, so that was quite low and it kind of knocked policy off a little bit. But we did that on COVID anyway.
I'm sorry, just a second one on toilets. I'm sorry, I'm going to make you talk about it a bit more. There seems to be quite a sort of strong feeling against it. I wondered if that's maybe down specifically at certain sites rather than the proposal in general. I was, you know, I'm thinking of sort of Harrison Drive, you know, on short places like that. Is there any way was that question asked, or was it just a broad sort of, do you agree with this proposal?
Where people have actually made comments specifically to that proposal, they were talking about a couple of different things. The first one you mentioned was tourism and businesses in the area. The second one you were talking about was older residents and people who were necessarily a little bit more vulnerable, people who didn't want to necessarily go to a cafe or go to a shop or anything like that. So there are two different things, broad themes. What I can do, if it would help, if it was at your council of events and ask them to see if I can do a geographical analysis of it. But that wouldn't tell you that you're specifically asking about that area.
It just one of them profoundly affects people with disabilities. That's an issue that I don't know as well.
Dave? Thanks, Chair. Just to follow up on that issue of the toilet, and again, we'll be interested to know whether the people who have responded after all over the road is living as I do in Melbourne. Right near to Bellis Lane, out to Royal Road. Those toilets are incredibly used a lot, I put it that way, when people obviously go on very many walks from New Brighton down to the and they are in constant use, and I very much fear, as we've seen on there, it's probably one of the ones that's got the most strong disagreement to closure. So I hope that will be taken fully into account when we come to the final decision. So my own personal knowledge of the area.
Well, she can very happily use the
mask.
Process just very briefly. And then obviously we can just go into a sort of more discussion about which option was as you see fit. But the process was that there was a series of four meetings, initially a screening meeting, and as Councillor Sullivan said, Councillor Sullivan was the chair, and then there was also representation from Councillor Williams, also Councillor Dave Mitchell and Alan Brickhouse. So the scoping meeting was the sort of stage at the outset as well, which actually Councillor Hale attended the scoping meeting where we looked at the prioritisation of the budget options. I think we've seen from the presentation that Ken did at the start that the right decision was made there really. In terms of page 3 of the report, explains really the process of that prioritisation. And so on page 3, just to reference what it says, the six budget options out of 11 were prioritised, and obviously they're featured in detail in the report. And these options were selected in recognition of the level of savings proposed, the public interest they would generate, and initial consideration of their impact if implemented. So the other five, we did talk through the other five, and that was how we came to that, or how the panel came to that agreement. It's important just to point out that the other five were generally considered to be about increased revenue generation, which was generally accepted as a direct contract for the council. Although some concern was highlighted about the proposal around charging for allotments of bowling greens and football pitches, that the respective percentage increases are not being consistently applied, and that was one of the observations, even though that wasn't looked at in further detail. The format of the report then, I'm not going to go through the report line by line, but what the report sets out really is the process in terms of the detailed discussions. So there's two main question and answer sessions that were held with officers. And we have got officer representation tonight to answer any questions, any technical questions about the report. But essentially those two sessions were for the panel to ask, go into a lot more detail and ask the searching questions about the added proposals. And so what we've done in terms of the presentation of the report is present each of the options as the context for the service that we have the option, the proposal in detail, the impact of the proposal, and then the conclusions of the panel. And so really, rather than go through line by line, we think the idea of this session is for members just to explore what the conclusions of the panel were into each of the options and have any further discussions and ask any further clarifications or questions about the process of each of the options. So I suggest we just go through the six in the context page there, Chair, in front of you, and ask those that have got any points that you want to go into.
Can you put the mic on, please? Because I can't hear you. Sorry. Thank you.
What we said was that we were trying to pick out the ones that the short time we had available for the meeting to be arranged. Trying to pick out those that the probably most of the issue with the management of the and that's how we picked those six. And as regards to the five, we didn't expect any votes or whatever on the bottom. Took those out of the equation and put them less important. So that didn't mean to say that this was any of the things that the members called for as well.